Good morning. Second day of our conference, Enterprise Agility, Maturity Matters. And I believe, I'm pretty sure that some years from, several years from now, I hope sooner, we are going to see companies who are truly agile and who have achieved this enterprise level agility and are demonstrating better and better results. And we all will be able to learn from them. But nowadays, there is still something which worries me, and I would like to talk about it. Okay. Before stepping to it, I would like to ask you from all of you who are in the room, how many of you are involved in agile initiatives, agile transformations, change initiatives, lean agile transformations? Okay. Yeah. Okay. This is something which also statistics says. Like 97% of the companies are involved in agile transformations, are actively using agile practices. Okay. For Spain, this is 70% of large organizations are involved and using agile practices on a daily basis. However, only 6% of these companies report that these practices help them really become better and more adaptive on current, in current market conditions. This means that from this room, if all of you or almost all of you are involved in such initiatives, this means that maybe only 4 or 5 people will be able to stand up and say, yes, we are really truly adaptive to the market conditions in which we live. And the most frustrating thing of this, yeah, why this fact worries me? First, because the difference between the numbers 97 and 6 or 17.6 shows a big gap between the expectations of the companies when they start agile initiatives and what they really get out of them. So we somehow have to find a solution to reduce this gap, to make it smaller and or at least to make the development of these expectations make it faster for the companies. Okay? And also my personal experience and experience of other coaches like me who share their observations in companies show that sometimes for some companies it takes about 2 years only to start. Why? Because the first step they do is restructuring the organization in order to introduce the agile structure for an organization. And introducing this agile structure takes 2 years sometimes. Sometimes they have to fire people who do not support this agile structure. And they, of course, spend lots of money and lots of expectation of people are met too late indeed in such situations. So we really have to think about how to resolve this gap between these numbers. And the most frustrating thing for me in such situations is that when we talk with companies who have already started their agile transformations maybe a year or 2 years ago, and we speak with people from the teams, they say something like this. We do all the agile ceremonies, we do all the agile practices, which we were taught, but we don't see a difference in the, at the organizational level. We see that we are still functioning the same way as before. And then we talk with program managers, department managers, area managers, this middle-level management in the companies, and then say something different, with different words, but more or less the same meaning. We are doing lots of effort on developing products in a more agile manner, delivering results faster to the customers, satisfying the customers in a better way, but somehow it's still difficult for us and we are struggling to start working as an agile organization, seeing that all the business units, all the areas are working in an aligned manner and prioritizing their work with common criteria and really think together on a common business purpose. Okay? And when we talk with executives, we see or we hear similar message. We are doing lots of effort. We are paying to lots of consultants to come and work and help our teams. But in the end, we are wondering whether the old way of working was so bad, or in fact, it was more effective and we were achieving more with the previous practices. And this is really frustrating and worrying for me. Okay? So, if we want to see a difference, the question is not what we want to see as a difference, but rather how we want to make this difference. Because it's about us. We have to create this difference which we want to see. Okay? And for me, the question is, which is this key element, if possible, one element only, which is so important for the all these change initiatives in the organizations that can really bring this difference, which we all look at. We all want to see at team levels, at middle level management, and also executives. So what do you think? I know that there are always lots of factors that influence agile initiatives, but if you only have to name one single factor, which would it be?
Mindset.
Mm-hmm. Focus. Business focus.
Personal greed.
Personal greed. What does it mean? Exactly.
Like wants to make a career.
Ah, wants to make a career. Yeah. Maybe I agree to some extent, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, mindset, focus.
Measuring.
Measuring. Very important, of course.
Measuring the right thing.
Measuring the right thing, the important thing, yes.
Sometimes measuring is not good.
Measuring, yes.
There should be a need.
There should be a need.
Work.
Of course, yeah. Let's assume that there is a need to change because the market is going very quickly. The changes happen very quickly every day. So let's assume that companies start these change initiatives because there is a need of change. But then, which is this factor? Because if they start changing something, because even having a need, I think we have a completely different problem. But I would like rather focus on the problem that we realize that there is a need for our business to change and to become more agile, more flexible, then which is this key element which would make the difference for our organization. And I was thinking and thinking and taking lists and observing what works well and what doesn't work well in the organizations. And my answer to this question is having a clear purpose, which is more or less focus. A clear purpose to me is something which defines what we expect to see with everything we do, what we expect to see for our teams, for our stakeholders, for our customers, for our organization, and for our business. And all these elements, we have to have them clear, and they will be able to drive us to achieving this purpose. And the first question, if the need comes from the market, of course, the first question should be, who our customers are? Do we know who our customers are? Do we know what they request us to do? Do we understand well their expectations? Are we capable to meet these expectations? If they expect from us delivering something on time, be it product or service or a combination of products and services, how much does it take us to deliver this outcome to the customer? What is our delivery pace? Is it sustainable? Do we deliver good quality products to this customer? Or if we do not deliver on time, do we know which are the reasons for which we are slow? Do we know which are the reasons for which we do not deliver good quality and the customers are claiming back that we have to rework something? Do we know what our flow efficiency is? Do we have a balance between the demands which we receive from the customers and our capability to respond to this demand? And of course, do we improve? Because the adaptation, in fact, is our ability to respond to changes and to get better and better in these new conditions, market conditions in which we have, in which we work. The problems I see in organizations and also what we see with other coaches is that although these concepts and these terms are somehow included in are included in all the Agile principles and in the Agile manifesto and Agile practices, the problems which we see, especially in non-IT organizations, is that sometimes we see that people try to apply practices for Agile software development in non-software development environment. And then we crash because starting from the vocabulary, it's different, and people sometimes do not understand all these terms that are proper to software development, and then the practices are not so natural. So instead of trying to simply copy and trying to comply to these practices that are defined for agile software development, not for developing agility, organizational agility in any context, we'd rather focus on understanding who our customers are, how what we deliver to them, and what is the capability of our delivery to the customers. And of course, we have to ask, in addition to this, we have to ask ourselves, are we fit for this purpose which we have defined? Okay. What would it mean, being fit for purpose? Okay. So starting from the objectives which we have defined, it would mean measuring, tracking, but tracking the progress and measuring the right thing. Okay. Measuring based on data, and taking objective, correct decisions, relevant decisions related to this purpose which we have defined. Ask ourselves whether we are defining relevant actions for the weaknesses which we identify in our processes, for the weaknesses which we identify in how we manage our work. So all the data will help us to define these relevant and congruent actions. Do we act in an aligned manner? Do we all in all the programs, all the business units, all the areas in the organization act with the same way of thinking, with the same principles of managing our work? So these are questions which we need to ask ourselves. And also, are we capable to anticipate changes, not simply reacting and going behind the market, but being able to anticipate changes to the market? If we don't have a purpose defined, very frequently we see that coaches, in fact, do what they can do because nobody has defined a purpose for them. So they are aware, they know very well, or they are certified in a certain method, and they simply go to the organizations and apply these methods. So this can change if the organization asks them to help them to achieve a particular purpose. Then the question, can you give an agile training to my team, won't be the right question. The right question would be, can you help my overburdened team to manage better their work and deliver on customer expectations? And then agile coaches and organizations are going to work in a completely different manner. Right? If we have a clear purpose, then starting from executive levels, the management of the agile initiatives, the direction of this change would be different. Then we are not going to have to answer the questions how many teams are doing daily meetings. The question would be, how do we meet the expectations of our customers? And if possible, show me this by means of data. so that we can all focus on which is the right problem which we have to resolve and which are the appropriate decisions which we have to take. And if we see that we have services which are underperforming, then let's focus on these services and see what we can decide and how we can improve them. Then we can talk about actions which will help us become fitter for purpose, satisfy better the expectations of our customers in a sustainable manner. So we always look at these two aspects. Satisfying our customers, of course, because without the customers, we don't have a business, but also delivering continually good products and services in a sustainable manner. This means taking care of the people, not overloading, not overburdening the teams. Okay, so this is the question. These are the important topics to discuss at this level. If we focus the conversations on these important things, we stop talking about whether Agile would bring us some benefits and things like this, which is very general discussion, and in the end, instead of trying to persuade people that, yes, Agile is a good idea, let's try things like this, we substitute all these conversations by let's focus on the things that are important for us. Our business, our customers, and our people who deliver these products and services. And then we start talking about which are the risks for not delivering good products and services in a sustainable manner. Okay. Middle-level management, the most difficult level of management. Program managers, business unit managers are always at this difficult position because they have to transfer, convey, and link strategic objectives and daily work of the organizations. So for these people, again, instead of trying to review what their people and supervise what their teams do and whether they apply well all the practices and whether all the practices are applied as the manual says or things like this, they should simply focus on whether they are fulfilling the service level agreements which they have with their customers, whether they serve well their demand, whether there is a demand which maybe they should not serve at all, or maybe there is a new demand appearing, which they have to start thinking on how they have to respond to it. Coordination between teams is one of the most difficult problems in organizations, because especially coordination between programs, between business units. Okay? So if we have a clear purpose at a business level, at organizational level, then this somehow facilitates enables the coordination between different programs and different business units in the organization. Why? Because we start thinking, we start controlling what we deliver, our services, our products. So we start really talking about the right things. And if we improve coordination at this middle level, management of the organizations, then the entire management for the teams becomes easier. Because the coordination, the policies which we use for managing, for coordinating different teams and different business units are developed and are decided at this level. So all this facilitates the policies and the way of working at team levels. Then at team level, the typical problems which team members complain with that we still have frequent interruptions, frequent changes of priorities, too much work to do, we don't know what is important, too many customers asking us to do different things, and in the end we don't know who we have to pay more attention and who is more important than the other. All these things become much clearer. I don't say that magic will happen and everything will be absolutely clear just after a meeting and a conversation, but it really helps a lot focusing and facilitating these criteria that teams need to make their decisions. Okay. If program managers and business unit managers help teams to define these criteria for making decisions on their daily basis, in fact, what we are seeing in organization is this kind of decentralizing management, and people and teams are really more autonomous in making their decisions because they have a clear idea and have a clear purpose, which is well explained from top to bottom. Okay. And then it's easier for teams to make decisions. What do we do now? What do we start focusing on working it now, what we can postpone for later, or what we won't be doing at all in this organization. If program managers have clear purpose on satisfying services and delivering on, in particular times, meeting service level agreements, then they start focusing on limiting work in progress. Because they understand that the only way to start delivering better services is through limiting this work in process, which we have as a practice in the Kanban method. And this is one of the most difficult practices in the method. All of you who have practiced Kanban, you know that we always struggle with convincing people that this would help them. But I start thinking that if we really want to focus on achieving service levels, then limiting the work in progress is the first practice that will help them. And this reduces the overburdening of the teams, which is precisely what all the teams would like to see. And this is what helps them deliver better results. And this is what helps the team to find out which is this time for each one of the service or for service levels which they can commit to deliver. Otherwise, it's very difficult for them to have a predictable process. Okay. So my experience and what I have shared also with other coaches is that if we really want to see a difference, we'd rather set a purpose. And I think that this purpose should become the real north for our organization. We have to measure for this purpose, for achieving this purpose, because only measuring this purpose will help us understand whether we are getting closer to this purpose. Keep in mind that defining this purpose, we still do not have the map for reaching this status. It's something like a destiny. We would like to achieve it, but we do not have the clear path to this. So in addition to measuring how close we are to these expectations of the customers, we need to make experiments in order to find which is the right path, because only through experiments we will be able to see which are the effective practices which will help us move towards this purpose. Okay? And this purpose, of course, have to be clearly communicated to all the people. And we have to use all these criteria which we define for managing our teams, for managing our customers, for understanding their demand, for understanding the needs of our stakeholders and of our business. And these are the indicators which we need to use to manage our business. Thinking on your organizations, which are the purposes which you use? Which are the objectives of your initiatives?
Profit.
Profit for the business? Any aspect related to the customer?
The customer brings the profit.
The customer brings the profit. So how do we make sure that the customer pays in the end?
Delivering good service.
Okay, good. And what are the criteria for delivering a good service?
Customer pays for it in the long term.
Okay. Good. Exactly. So do you know these problems? Or we assume that the customer calls us with particular problems and we resolve them. So do you think that you have a good understanding of the needs, of the problems that you resolve for the customer?
In real life.
In your organization?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you measure how well you resolve these problems? You could do better in measuring. Okay, good. It's at least you know what you can do better.
Yeah.
Okay.
We do measure, but can do better.
Mm-hmm. Who is defining the purpose in the organizations?
C-level.
If we think that a purpose should include all these aspects, teams, organizational objectives, customer expectations, and business profit objectives, who are the levels in the organizations who have really a good or even sometimes the best understanding of the customer needs and the customer problems which we are resolving? Support, problem, services, yeah. So it's very important that when we are defining this purpose, we put together all these aspects, starting from the teams, from the support teams, from the service teams, because they have this good understanding of the customer needs and the customer problems. They know why the customer calls. And of course, we have to combine this with the understanding of our business, how much profit we want to make, what kind of customers we want to work with, what kind of services we want to deliver to these customers, and what kind of services we do not want to deliver to such customers. Okay? So the management is responsible for defining the purpose. Of course, the management has to work with all the teams, with the entire organization. They have to collect all this feedback, but we cannot expect that the teams will define, or the support teams, or the service, the people directly involved in the services, that they will define the purpose for our organization. It's a management job, and the management has to set this purpose. The management has to lead towards this purpose. That's why we define all the metrics. That's why we define all the criteria for satisfying the purpose, and this is what guides us, this is what allows the management to guide and lead the organization towards this purpose. And from analyzing all the points which we still have to improve, we are measuring something, but we see that we have to improve still. We think that we have a quite good customer service, but we still have to improve something. So again, the management is responsible for enabling this improvement, for understanding the causes, the root causes for these situations, for these pitfalls, and facilitate the introduction of right approaches, right practices for achieving this purpose. And if we work in a similar, in such condition, it's a lot easier, I would say, for coaches, at least for me, because it's clear what we want to improve. We have a clear situation, clear purpose, clear problems, or maybe not so clear sometimes. We have to facilitate clarifying these problems, but it makes the activities and the coaching activities a lot easier for the organizations. Okay? So, what kind of guidance can we provide to all levels of the organizations for facilitating their path to the service? Okay, we are here, you know, we talk about Kanban and the Kanban maturity model, so there are alternative approaches, I'm sure. I know some of them, but I would like to talk with you about what we would like to suggest as an approach by means of the Kanban maturity model. So for organizations, I'm sorry for the small fonts. You understand that I will refer to the big posters of the Kanban maturity model, so, but I will explain you what you don't see, because I don't see it even from here. Okay. So for organizations who would like to see achievement of results and are still rather at the level of managing individual work, managing the tasks of all the people who are involved in this, we have these practices, very simple practices for visualizing work and managing the work of the individuals. This is not a true organization. This might be the case when we have a person organization, one person organization, but this is, we also see these situations, these cases in larger organizations in which we have individuals who are so much specialized in some tasks that in fact only they are performing this work, and that's why in fact they become like a person organization. They are managing their work. Of course, we all of us know that we have to reduce these cases, and it's always useful to have people transmitting this knowledge to other people, just to avoid situation that someone goes skiing and afterwards has 3 months of, because he has fallen there and he has 3 months leave at home, and this of course is a can become a big obstacle for our process. So, but still at this level, what if you are only focused at this level, what you can obtain with these practices is just getting things done at individual level. Okay. If this is not enough for your organization and you are interested in developing the teamwork and making people collaborate and start working together, developing the transparency in the teams, then we have a bunch of other practices related to developing teamwork, visualizing work at the team level, limiting work in progress in order that the team can deliver more results in shorter time, establishing some practices for managing the work at the team level. That's why this maturity level is called team-focused. And what you can get as an outcome of these practices is collaborative teamwork and less overburdening for the team. So by this level, what we address is mainly this part of this aspect of the purpose, which is of the organizational purpose, which is related to reducing overburdening at the team levels. Okay? So we continue. And going further, if we are really focused on delivering good projects, good services, this means that we have to start understanding our workflow end to end and understanding how it goes through different teams or different specializations or even different business units. Okay? This requires that we need to understand better how we manage the dependencies between all these teams in order to be able to manage the entire workflow from the beginning to the end. Okay? And at this level, we introduce this orientation to the customer, and we start acting on this other aspect of our purpose, which is related to the customer, understanding what the customer expects from us, what is the demand of the customer, how much demand we receive, whether there are some patterns in this demand, when do we receive particular requests, when we do not receive these particular requests, whether the flow is smooth enough through all the teams, which are the issues that impede that this flow is smooth enough, and how we resolve these blocking issues, which are the reasons for which the customer is sometimes not happy, and we receive the requests back because we have to rework them. So as an outcome of introducing these practices, what we obtain at organizational level is the first thing, consistent process. We understand what the process is and how we have to manage it. The outcome from the customer from customer's perspective is not yet consistent. We still see that when we have to align different teams, this doesn't happen so easily and it's not so smoothly. So therefore, from customer's perspective, we still see complaints from the customer. But we start analyzing these complaints and we get a better understanding of how we can improve the processes in order to respond to these complaints. Okay. And as an outcome of all these activities, we obtain a better understanding and better policies for better coordination between the teams. Okay. And this is not enough, because if we really want to deliver good services in order to get good profit for the business, we have to establish, we have to reach also this consistency from customer perspective. And these are the practices which we have at maturity level 3, and these are the practices for organizations who really value delivering on customer expectations, satisfying the customers, understanding which are the services which we still have to improve the performance, their performance, or which we are underserving the customers, which are the services maybe where we overserve our customers. And we are delivering, we are developing the strong customer focus at this level. Okay. We introduce all the metrics at this level, all the key performance indicators. We start collecting data. Our organization is already prepared for collecting this data. We analyze this data. We make decisions based on these data. The process is consistent. The outcome is consistent from customer perspective. There is a balance between the demand and capability. This means that our teams are not overburdened, or at least the overburdening is reduced a lot. There still might be some peaks of work, but overall, there is a balance between the demand and the capability. We are meeting all the expectations, both of the customers and also regulatory compliance. We have a regulatory compliance, and we improve a lot in predictability. In fact, reaching the definition of these service levels improves, in fact, the predictability. And yeah, these are the benefits which we observe. And at this level, we start defining improvement initiatives, because we have to find this path to our purpose, and we have to find the most effective path. So we have to focus on what in our processes is not working well yet, and we have to define how we can improve it. And always these small elements that are not working well in our process, they are specific for the processes. So the improvements at this level become natural and specific for the business or for the organization we work with. They are not improvements that come from the book and we simply have to do because someone has suggested these practices. We start working on particular improvements for our organization, for our business unit. Okay. And going further, applying these practices, what we observe is that we start addressing better this fourth aspect from the purpose, namely the expectations of the stakeholders. So here we can start talking about improving the economics of our services, improving the profits. Because we already have a good way, a good consistent process, efficient process for developing the delivering the services, and we can continue delivering consistent services, but finding ways to improve the economics and get more benefits, economic benefits for our organizations. And at this level is when we are already able to anticipate changes in the market, because we have this good understanding both of the customer expectations and how well we do our job and deliver the products and the services for the customer. So at this level, we can start talking about, we observe sustainable outcomes in the organizations, okay? So I assume that most of you think that, yeah, this is a very good theory, but the real life is somehow different. And that's why I would like to tell you that during this last year of validating, piloting the Kanban maturity model, we have seen good examples, very good examples of applying and reaching some of these benefits through the Kanban maturity model. We have some of these examples here. For example, we have people who have made the difference in their organizations. We have Nagore Bilbao from BBVA here. She's the program manager who made a difference in their organization in BBVA Finance. She's a program manager of core data. Core data, as it's their name says, is in the core of many projects and services that they are developing. And they were really struggling with very high demand, limited capability, because the people were the people who are, frequent changes of priorities, and they always had to deliver on time. So starting with this focusing on the right purpose, focusing on understanding first the demand of our customer, what they expect from us, what do we really do, how is the time of our people spent on which services, not how many hours they work on, this helped them create this good understanding of their demand, their capability, identify what they can improve in their processes, and reach the moment in which they defined four improvement initiatives specific for their program and achieving improvement. So this is a real case. Another real case comes from National Nederlanden. The Department of Business Employee Benefits, under the management of José Manuel García, right? Only 5 months after starting with using Kanban in their teams, they report 30% reduction of their delivery time to their customers. And something very interesting, they observe that they start working in a more collaborative manner with their customers. They see, they observe that the customers show more commitment to what they are delivering. They are focused very much on their services, and they pay attention on the upstream, how they prepare the demand in order that the downstream flow afterwards is really smooth. And Noelia Ruiz is the team lead in José Manuel García's department, and she was the first one as a team lead who reported that we see important improvement in our work as a team, and we see this reduction of overburdening, and we see that we are really doing our job better and we are delivering better work. And they are really proud of their work. So these are real examples that show that somehow this gives results. So the Kanban maturity model, we believe that based on the experience of lots of companies, well, maybe not a lot, but some, maybe 10 companies who piloted it during this last year, we see it as a tool, a guiding tool, which can help organizations to understand where they are, to understand which their customers are, to define their purpose, to understand better their situation and be able to see which are the weaknesses in their current situation and how they can drive the organizations toward their purpose, define this route through experimentation, of course, and walk the path and track progress of this of all these initiatives. Okay. So, how do you see it? What ideas? Yeah, this is the second day we are talking about the Kanban maturity model. What ideas do you think you can apply, or which are the things that you still see that I'm not quite sure yet how this could work in our organization? And yeah, I have reserved some. Yes, that's why I reserve some time. I hope that.
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation. I have a question regarding projects and services. Mm-hmm. There's this belief that if you work on projects, you should do Scrum or SAFe or anything. And then Kanban and the KMM in particular is applicable for services or non-project work. What do you think about that?
Thank you for this question, and I'm happy to receive it before we finish the book, because if really this is the impression that the Kanban in the Kanban maturity model is for services only and not for projects, then we have to improve the explanation. Kanban and the Kanban maturity models are also for project work. The difference between a project and a service, well, typically we associate project development with delivering a product, with developing a product, and we know that there is a start date, there is an end date. But if we consider this work which we have to deliver from customer perspective, the customer expects typically this product which we are going to deliver by certain date. This means that we have to deliver on time, which is delivering on time is something which is common both for developing products and delivering services. Okay? And simply, the customer expectations in this case, in the case of projects, include a product. Okay, include something which is more tangible, which is the difference between receiving a service, which sometimes is not so tangible. For example, a training service, it's intangible. Right? Buying a book is something tangible. Okay? But delivering a book on time has the same characteristics. Again, we have to deliver something on time. We have to control this delivery. So internally, how we organize this, in fact, we have to split the entire project into smaller pieces, which we deliver during the project development. And we can see these smaller pieces as delivering smaller services. In fact, the participation of different specialists in the development of a product is kind of service which they deliver to the entire team of big team of specialists who are involved in this project development. So Kanban is addressing all these aspects as well. And that's why in the Kanban maturity model, we have practices which are named like this project portfolio, Kanban board, for example. It is about projects. Or program management Kanban board, where we see the status of different projects. Okay, so I hope that. But we will revise this particularly and make sure that it's clear in the second revision of the book.
Not necessarily a question, and maybe it's more for the leadership retreat or something, but kind of a bigger picture on that same topic is like, I'm constantly fighting this battle of, oh, it's only for, Kanban's only for sustaining engineering or service or support versus new product development, greenfield product development. It's like, well, you can't do that. You can't use Kanban for that. So I'm more interested is like, I mean, just interviewing candidates for management positions, and I ask them about their software development lifecycle process, and they will generally not bring up Kanban. When I ask them about Kanban, they'll say, oh, well, that's just for service or supporting software. It's not really for our operations. It's not really for building software. So how do we change that mindset? What are the things that we can do to change that mindset, not just at our individual companies, but maybe a broader area? So I don't know if this is the right question for here, but something to
think
about.
Yeah, I understand this concern. I would rather ask the question, maybe we have to stop talking about separating so much projects and products and services. We start to talk more about managing the work. So the question is not whether the work we have to deliver is a product or project or service, but rather what we have to deliver for the customer, which are the requirements, how we develop them, and do we understand what is the status of this work? Do we understand what is the timeline which we have to use for this, for managing this, delivering this work? Are we capable of delivering on time? And if we start talking about work, I think this entire discussion about whether it's project or service is, I think either it becomes clear or even obsolete, because in the end, we have to deliver what the customer expects from us.
Okay.
Okay. Well, thank you very much then. I think we are just on time for the coffee break. Do we have a coffee break? So we don't. Okay, no time for coffee break.